Yeah, a warm good afternoon, everyone. Hope you are all safe and doing good. Today we have our session titled Epidemiological Studies, Need and Types. So this is a continuous medical education program in collaboration between SMR and JP. So today we have our honorable speaker, Professor and Dr. A.M. Kadri. So SAR is having more than 25 years of teaching experience. SAR is currently the Executive Director, State Health System Resource Center, Gujarat, Health and Family Welfare Department, Gujarat. SAR is Editor-in-Chief of IAPSM's Textbook of Community Medicine. SAR is currently holding the position Office of Secretary General of Indian Association of Preventive and Social Medicine. SAR served as Joint Editor in Gujarat State AIDS Control Society for 5 years from 2005 to 2010 and has been national level resource person on HIV and AIDS and part of various committees during the tenure. SAR was secretary for IAPSM Gujarat chapter from year 2011 to 2017. SAR has been various committees associated with various committees of health for Gujarat state. SAR played a crucial role in strengthening the healthcare system, medical education and health promotion, which are his keen area of interest. SAR is having more than 40 research papers and articles in his credit in various indexed national and international journals. Today we are feeling very privileged to have you, sir. Please take the session.
Thank you. So good morning, everybody. I think I am audible, isn't it? So now I can start with my presentation. In fact, I have chosen the topic Epidemiological Studies, Need and Types. This is the, I think, first interaction with the medical students on this platform through this agency. So I thought I should start with the topic which is the core area of the community medicine subject. And it is not the only core area of the community medicine subject, I would be saying, but it is also very important area in the medical sciences also. And that's why, in fact, epidemiology is considered as the mother of the many of the medical sciences also. And when we are seeing that COVID pandemic, when we have witnessed the COVID pandemic, then we have seen that many of the epidemiological terms and topics are being discussed in the even people amongst the general people as well, like epidemic curve, what R factor is there, flattening of the curve, or something like we are saying that variants and surveillance, control, etc. All these are types of terminologies we are now listening because of this COVID pandemic. So it is, you know, that this epidemiological science is very important, not only the managing the COVID pandemic only, but in fact it is has got the very well vast scope touching every discipline of the community medicine. And that's why I chosen that what is the need of epidemiological studies and what are the different types of the medical studies which can be these epidemiological studies which can be used for medical sciences. So this is the purpose of selecting this topic I will be starting with. Now before starting, I would like to have some context setting along with you, or I will say tickling your nerve cells. So let me start with the one question. There might be the chances that you cannot give, there is a live interaction what we are typically on offline lecture we are having, but definitely this will be in a way online interaction, I will be saying. So my first question is that in your hostel, suppose you come to know that one of the student who is living in your hostel is getting, now he is having the complaint of diarrhea. So what will you do? So what the first thing in your mind immediately will come in your mind that, okay, the one student is having the diarrhea, we should immediately take to the doctor. He should take the drugs prescribed by the doctors. He should be properly examined and prescribed the drugs. And he should take the drugs. Then over the period of time, he may get cured. That is the only thing you will be thinking about when you are dealing with a case of a diarrhea. But after some time, you come to know that 5 students are having diarrhea. Now, what would be your reactions?
Yes, sir, there may be an outbreak, a small.
Yeah, very good. So your reaction is that somebody is saying that there may be an outbreak. So there are the two. I would be saying some students like some people may think about, okay, one is that now five people is having the diarrhea. So, okay, we will take these five people and get them examined by the doctors and get treatment. Somebody like what someone has said that it means that something outbreak like something is there. So we have to think about the in terms of the outbreak. And when we are talking about the in terms of the outbreak, what the thinking will be go? When we'll be thinking about in terms of the clinically examining the that student and curing it. And when we are thinking about in terms of the outbreak, other thinking, other directions of the thinking will go. So before going, after some time, someone inform you that there are total 30 students out of the 100 students having complaint of the diarrhea. So now what earlier said that there is outbreak. But definitely there is outbreak, but now the 30 students are having the complaint, then definitely it is not only the matter of action that taking to them to hospital and getting them cured, but now your concern will be also now will be more than that. Now, typically, I think that you must all people started thinking about 30 students diarrhea. It means something is wrong in the hostel. Something is wrong there. And that's why people are having 30 students of the diarrhea. Whether these are the only 30 students are having the diarrhea or more are there. Or other people or other. So what are the questions will come in your mind when I will be saying that, like somebody said, there is an outbreak. That is the question or that is the definitely impression you are now carrying with you. So that thing will become in your mind. But what other questions you will come in mind? 30 students are having the diarrhea. What questions will be there in your mind?
Yes, sir. Like because it is in a hostel, there may be a chances of contamination of food. So is 30 students taking a common diet, or is 30 students are associated with a common point where we can track the source of infection or the reason for the thing, maybe food or maybe water or some else like pathogen, like any pathogen has commonly infected all of them.
Very good. So that is the one thing. Any other thing, any student, other students will be thinking that there should be some other question may crop up in your mind of in other students or in you, if in your mind. So immediate concern is that not only the cure, but your along with the cure, there is your concern that there is what should be the source of it. When we are having the diarrhea in the family, you always say, "Kya khaya tha? What you have eaten yesterday night?" Isn't it always we are asking about? So one thing is that definitely when we are thinking that people are having the diarrhea, so we are saying that what the person has consumed, that consumption. So it is, we are directly trying to link it with the diet. But again, the people, the five people we would have eaten the same diet and out of them only one people have done. Also, these out of 100 students, they may be like in a hostel, they may be having last night, some birthday party may be there and some they have also some food they have brought outside. So that may be the one reason. But it might happen that out of 30 students, it might happen that 20 students may have not eaten the cake or some food from their birthday party, though there was a birthday party they have not attended. It means that some other source may be there, isn't it? So likewise, there will be five or four different causes you will crop in your mind. Maybe water, maybe food, maybe some contaminated food, or maybe cake, maybe ice cream, maybe stale foods from the hostel, food from outside, or water consumed from the hostel, or water brought by the some source like a water container they have bought from the packaged drinking supplier, etc. So all different five, six things will be coming. So immediate your concern will be not only the cure, your concern will be identifying the what are the cause behind this. So your concern from cure to shifted to the cause as well. But out of cause, now there will be confusion. I will be saying that four or five things, culprits will be there. And when we are identifying suspects or the culprits, definitely police is investigating it, and police is investigating, and then they are generating the evidences. And when they are then generating evidences, and based on generating evidences, they are convicting the persons. So culprit evidences and conviction, something like. So that is there happening. But this can be this can happen for the criminal scenario we are talking about. When it comes to the medical scenario, how these evidences can be generated? Just my assumption will be sufficient, my observation will be sufficient, or something more required that you will be confidently saying that this may be the cause, food may be the cause, food or the water may be the cause, or a cake may be the cause, or maybe the ice cream or the some stale basudi will be the cause. What will be the cause out of the 10 food items or the water items or 2 or 3 water sources? What may be there? So that will be the one question. Second question will, why you want to know the cause? Then that definitely is another question, because when you are knowing the cause, you are interested to not only now curing the that particular 30 students, you are also interested to not preventing that this 30 won't become the 31, 32 or 40. And that's why identifying the cause is called jo hona tha ho gaya. It is not like so that whatever the happen, it has happened. No, you are interested if we are allowing this source of infection to be there, continue there, then this 30 will become the 100 and all people will be infected. And that's why along with the cure, we require the prevention. But the, for that, we have to identify the actual culprit or the source of infection, something like. So that this is the thing, how these evidences can be generated, that we have now will be. And for that, the answer is epidemiological studies. And that is why, in fact, we had to need study epidemiological studies. Further going into the detail, this is the your scenario I have given in your from your life situation. But now some other questions you may have come across frequently, similar kind of the question that I will be posing will be. So many times you will be coming to the people and they are your family member saying that somebody has died on this, and you are saying that he was smoking, and that's why smoking leads to the tobacco chewing leads to the occurrence of the cancer. Then immediately your relatives or some friend will be who is chewing this, say, no, see that Mr. XYZ was there. He was completely teetotaler, but he has developed the cancer. Similarly, say that this fatty food will lead to the cardiac heart attack, cardiac ailments, etc., hypertension. Then immediately say they can see that he's the very people, he's very saint like having the personality, but still he's having the heart attack. Something like frequent question you will be coming across, and you are seeing that, yeah, you yourself have seen that the person is not chewing anything, tobacco, something like, not having such high risk behavior, what we are in the medical science is saying, but still the person has developed. So, how to now counter that argument and convince them that whatever you are saying is observed is right, but it is not the correct. So observation is right, but the science or the knowledge is not correct. How you can say that? Why that you require to have the some evidences, and that some evidences you have to come with the not identifying one person that see that this person is having the tobacco chewing and he is having the cancer. So one, we are putting one person against another person, and we are saying people will say, okay, he will bring another person who is having the not chewing the tobacco, not having the tobacco habits, but still having the cancer. So this will keep on going otherwise. But we have to some methodologically prove it, and where the science of the epidemiological studies come into the head. So with that, again, I will be pondering some questions. I will putting some questions for wonder you. See, these are the example what I have said, that this on the left of the right of the my or the left of the screen, you, when you are seeing it, there is the BKS Iyengar. He is actually the yoga guru from the. He is the person who has actually popularized the yoga in India. He has died at the age of 96. So okay, we can say that, oh, very good, because of his yoga, he has increased his health, improved health, and his longevity, lived 96 year. But when we are looking at the another famous personality and Khushwant Singh, the what famous quote he is having, that I drink only 2 times in my life. One time is when it rains, another time is that when it does not rain. So he is that type of the consumer of the alcohol. He died at the age of 90 years. He was having the all the types of the bad habits which put the person at the high risk of the somebody ailments, etc. So what the inferences you will draw when you are making the comparison between these two celebrities, what inferences you will be drawing? So inferences is saying that if you are drinking whiskey, you will be having the 3 years age over the yoga. So whiskey is better than yoga. Is it acceptable? It is not acceptable. So one-to-one comparison is not an acceptable one comparison. We have to serve certain number of the people to compare it and making the comparison. But this number of the people, in fact, how we are choosing in them, how we are taking history, then how you are evaluating them, this all is important thing. Otherwise, it would happen that you will be choosing selectively, and then you will be getting the distorted the evidence or the conclusion. So that will be not actually giving you the right information, and that's why we have to some methodological have to adapt the studies, and for different situation, different purposes, these are the epidemiological studies we have to think about. Similarly, epidemiological studies, when we are talking about epidemiology and epidemiological studies, we are talking about similarly just what I have said, that when we say that tobacco kills, it causes the cancer, but we have seen that the Yuvraj Singh was having some cancer. So again, you know, in spite of that, he was not chewing the tobacco and he was a good athlete. So that is the thing. Another thing is that people are saying that you are familiar when in medical education, you have been said that this is the normal and this is the abnormal. If you are having less than 90 SBH systolic blood pressure and or less than 60 diabetes blood pressure, you'll be hypertension. If you are more than 140 or more than 99, then you definitely, if you are falling to 90, you are hypertension stage 1. Or similarly, WBC or the hemoglobin range, we are right saying that this is the normal range. Who decided this normal range? So first we have talked about the causes. This is causing. So how we are deciding causes was the question. And for that, we require the epidemiological. Similarly, who decides this normal? Again, my submission is that, again, that this deciding normal is also, we cannot just by looking at the 1%, 2%, or some random haphazardly picking up the 500 people and looking at their findings and saying that this is the normalcy, this is the range. In medical science, you say that I asked one of the students that, who told you that this is the hemoglobin more than less than 13% anemia? Sorry, it's written in the books. So for you, the fact is, since it is written in a book, but that information as a science, when printed or included as a part of the book, it has to pass through the stringent research and the epidemiological studies, trial of the epidemiological studies. And once it passed through it, and whatever the evidences are generated, then they are included. So for identifying normal or abnormal, also we require the epidemiological studies. Similarly, causes, just we have talked about the different causes then. So how you will come to know that this Anopheles mosquito is there, it will be spread, it is spreading malaria, Down syndrome. In fact, we are showing that when saying Down syndrome is a genetic disorder, how you identified heart attack, these are the symptoms of the heart attack, how you, we are going just identifying the causes or the syndromes, etc. How we are deciding, once we, so deciding this in methods, vectors, genetical, even causes behind cause, different elements, even the syndromes, also we require some epidemiological studies. Similarly, nowadays there is a debate, we should take this Covishield or this Covaxin, which one is better, etc. Similarly, whether it is effective or not effective, vaccine for the is effective COVID or not effective, how we are deciding? So some research and clinical trials, isn't it? The vaccine trials are going on, etc. So this is vaccine trial is part of the epidemiological studies. So which vaccine is, whether the vaccine is effective or not effective, or which vaccine is more effective or less effective. That's only based on, cannot be just by some brochure of the manufacturer we can claim. It has to be backed up by the, some data, and this data are the basically finding observations or results of the methodological study. Similarly, the for the drugs, which drug is better? You should prescribe this doxycycline for the cholera is the effective, or some, okay, fine, amoxicillin will be effective. Which one is better drugs? There are a number of the drugs available, but this drug is effective or this drug is not effective, this drug is more effective. So these types of also information, when it is in your textbook, but this textbook as a science, how they have come, that we have to think about, and that's why we require study. Similarly, these epidemiological studies gives another part, what I have talked about, is that also it gives an idea about that, like that smoking causes the cancer, we have said. But other findings also we have, so that somebody in the, we come to the literature that whatever the lung diseases we are seeing, out of them, 35% of the lung diseases are because of the tobacco. Similarly, 26% of are the, of all the cancers are the because of the tobacco. So there are the number of the cancers are there, but out of the 100 cancer patients, when we are seeing 26 are the because of the tobacco. Similarly, 11%. From where this magic figure of 35%, 26%, 11% has come, that is the, that's why that for we require methodological studies, and that is the epidemiological studies. So proportion, that attributions of the particular factors, cause, identifying the cause is one thing, and attribution of that cause in the total burden of the disease also can be identified or can be known by the epidemiological study only. This is the syndrome just I talked about. This is a symptom. Somebody says a step letter pattern of the fever is that for the typhoid. It is written in book. That's why, in fact, we are saying typhoid. But when people before 100 years, people are not aware. Fever for them, fever. But out of different types of the fever or the group of the syndromes will be leading to identifying as a chest, is a heart attack or group, or as a TB syndromes or as a malaria, etc. So how this clinical feature is fixed and the group of the clinical feature helping into the diagnosis or differential diagnosis, this all comes through not only just one or two single cases observation, but methodological study. So that is the another need of the case control study. Similarly, is for other group of syndromes yes, I am talking about. Similarly, complication to know that these are the complications of the disease. Disease can lead to these types of the complication. So that is also can be known by the epidemiological study. Which diagnosis we are knowing that the vaccine is better, which is better, which we can understand which drug is more effective and more effective. Similarly, which diagnostic method, whether the AFP will be doing microscopic examination will be better in diagnosis of the TB, or radiological examination of tuberculosis is better in the diagnosis of TB. Similarly, serological investigation is better, or which types of the serological different types of the test are there, whether better. So that is, in fact, diagnostic effectiveness and the correctness of the diagnostic also can be decided by the epidemiological study only. If we want to know about, then it can be done known by the epidemiological studies. So just we have talked about the drugs. Similarly, surgical also, which surgical will be having the better operating results, etc., can be also known by the some methodological studies. It's not by mere observation. Is that prognostic? That is the most, I think this will be the last. In fact, I will be just highlighting the need. This is one of the last. Typically, the question we always come across as a doctor many times is that, sir, what is the prognosis, doctor sir? How much chances that patient will survive? Patient will come out. Okay, 90% I'm confident about that he will be survived in case of serious patient usually. Or 50% chances are there, 50% will be there. How this 50-50 or 25% or 95% you are talking about the prognosis of that particular disease. Again, for that, for deciding that prognosis of that particular disease, like stage A cancer, stage B cancer, etc., stage 5 cancer, some epidemiological studies you require to have that knowledge as well. So this is all about the different epidemiological studies typically in the medical science and the populations or the community medicine science, I would be saying typically. So with this background understanding, now I am coming to the actual theoretical part about the my topic. Again, I am not coming to the epidemiological study. Before understanding the epidemiological studies, you first of all know what is the epidemiology, you should know about it. And then you will be moving to the epidemiological study. So when we are talking about the epidemiological study, so first of all, what is the epidemiology? As you all are learning, epi means upon, demos mean about the people, population. So what is basically, we are basically studying the population of people. We want to know the people, okay, when, where disease occur, how they are transmitted, how disease affects different types of the people, what are the methods of controlling or the curing or treating these patients, etc. And this all understanding is the epidemiology, what we have talked about earlier as a case, as a scenario, various medical science scenario we have talked about. And that is the of the epidemiology. Epidemiology started with the some observation of the data or to the prevention of excess. Some of the pioneers of the epidemiology will be saying, typically science has keep on evolving. People started with, when we are talking about the medical science, people started with the linking it with some superstitions, some and misconception, etc. People have developed. But over the period of a time, the experiences, they gain experience and they have done something, experiments as well. And they come to know certain facts, and that facts over the period of time tested, and they become this science. So three important, just I will be talking about the three important historical aspects. We have talked about one hypothetical conditions, one the real field conditions of the different medical situations, and we now talking about historical thing, which is again related with the epidemiology. Edward Jenner, the term vaccination has come. So he has started, has observed that the women, in fact, smallpox now it is eradicated, and this is the only disease which is eradicated, and now no virus is there on the planet except in these two laboratories for the record historical purpose it is kept there. But he has observed that some people are developing the smallpox rapidly, but milkmaids, they are not having the smallpox, or even if they develop the smallpox, they are not having some bad or severe form of the smallpox. It means that he has said that some immunity is there, and he come to know that they are cowpox is there, and milkmaids, because they are milking, involved into the job of milking, and during that time they got infection with the cowpox, and this cowpox in interaction with the virus, maybe of the at that time he was not knowing about the virus, etc. But because it is developing some immunity, so he has taken the some of the materials, liquid materials, and tried to inject it in the people, and he has experimented on his own child that whether it will be protecting once they impacted this serum from the cowpox injected to the, and then injected the substances or the liquid of the serum from the smallpox, and the child was protected or did not develop smallpox. And that's why with this experiment, though it is unethical, but experiment, he has given the birth to the concept of the vaccination. And this is how observation to the experimentation was carried out, and he has deduced it. But over the period of a time, then it becomes the science, and vaccination and immunization has become one of the important, immunology has become one of the important science of the medical science. John Snow, he is the believing that the germ theory, he was very much proponents of the germ theory of the disease. In 1844, like what we have talked about, cholera, diarrheal epidemic, there was the epidemic of diarrhea, and there were death in the one part of the London. He tried to see that there is some pattern. He sees that there is some pattern of the causes and death in there. So not everybody living in that particular streets or that particular geographical areas, they are have experienced the equal number of the diarrheal cases, or they have a number of the mortality. So he has tried to identify pattern, and out of that pattern, he has tried to link that there is one water pump in that particular time, a hand pump. Particular time, the waters are supplied by private agencies. So there two agencies will provide the water in that particular water that area. So he has identified that people who consume the water from that particular water bank, they are at the risk. They are having the showing the more death. So before knowing the Vibrio cholera, he has removed that pump from hand pump, handle of that hand pump, and automatically that epidemic has stopped. So he has tried to identify the source of infection without knowing the germ itself. So that is the one of the study, and that's based on study action. So he has studied the pattern of the disease and he has taken the action and it has ultimately given the result. Likewise, there was one of the Ignaz Semmelweis. He is considered as the father, actually the father of the disinfection. Right now we are talking about the wash our hand for the prevention of the transmission, protecting ourselves and prevention of the transmission of the COVID. But do you know the person, because of he is the first person who is advocated of washing hand in the clinic side, and he has been labeled by the colleagues and he has been tortured to the extent that he has died at the age of, he has become the mentally unstable, and he has died at the age of 47 because and he has been jailed and mental asylum, put into the asylum, died at the age of 47. Actually, when what he has observed that in that dose in the Vienna, it was the practice that people are going into the autopsy, that is the for autopsy, some medical students or the doctors are going and they are doing autopsy, and they are, after coming to the autopsy, they are immediately going into the obstetric, because everybody is having there. It is not like specialization what we are having, that every doctors are involved in every types of the job. So what it was seen that he has observed that in one particular ward there is the scheduling of that, where the doctors who are put into that particular ward and they are coming for the delivery, before delivery they are immediately having the posting at the autopsy, and once completing the autopsy they are immediately coming to their obstetric clinic and delivering the children, birth, giving the for the birth. And in other, where the directly without any posting the medical doctors are coming, there the fever is not there. So he has seen them on pattern that one ward is having more puerperal or childbed fever, and another bed is not there. But the change is there in that particular thing. The difference is what he had identified, that one is coming, doctors are coming from the autopsy room, another doctors are coming from other places. So what he has tried, that something, because they are doing autopsy with the hand and immediately without washing their hand, they are directly entering into the delivery procedure, and that's why they are infecting. So he has insisted in that particular ward for the that washing of the hand before the delivery, coming from the autopsy room and before the delivery. And immediately when it was come down, which was the mortality rate, what is high, is 15-30% has come down to below the 1%. But people had not subscribed that concept or his findings, in spite of that what he has experimented. So that is altogether different story. But this is the, but after his death, this is theory was established, and now he has got the place in specific place in this sepsis infection and sepsis science. So this is the how this, it was discovered. So that is the one of the important historical aspects about the these all I am talking about the studies. They are previously we have talked about that which are the just mere observation. Now out of mere observation, they have tried to this observation put into some methodological study. So these are the sort of a genesis of the or precursors of the what currently the more scientific or systematic method of study we are carrying out. They are the precursor of the present robust epidemiological studies. Similarly, James Lind, again it was one of the trial. In those days, in fact, when sailors were going into the field in the sea, and they have to stay there for more number days and months together. When they were staying, when they are returning back, so they develop the scurvy types like bleeding gums and some other diseases, etc. So here somewhere it has tried that this is linked. People who are not consuming, having the less citrus fruit, they are having such types of the, his observation was that they are developing such types of the syndrome complaints. So what he has did, he has now, he is more of the now just experiment to, he has now, it is tried to a control trial, converted it into the control trial. What he has did, he has prepared the citrus, some juices from the lime, and is given to the one group of the sailor, and the other group of the sailor he has also studied, but they are not given any types of the such juice. So he has made now comparison between these two groups. So when they are returning back from the, both the group have returned back from the their journey, people who have been consuming the citrus foods and or the juice, they were not having any complaint of the scurvy types of the syndrome, but the people, other people continued with that types of the thing. So it was now more refined types of the study he has carried out, and now just mere observation and just describing it, what John Snow has done, or just one single experiment, what the Edward Jenner has done, or what one experiment and not methodological comparison, but pre and post comparison was done for, by the this Vienna scientist Ignaz Semmelweis, and here making comparison against the experimental group to the control group. And he has made the comparison between these two. So, and this way, so another one science, in the science it was added. Now we are talking about that knowledge is added, that people for prevention of this scurvy should take the vitamin C or the lemon juices, etc. So this science has come through the refinement when these types of the new knowledges has come into the science. At the same time, more refined way of the methodologies of studying the medical conditions also parallelly being developed, and it has come into the at the level of the epidemiological studies. So medical sciences and the epidemiological studies development or evolvement go hand in hand. Similarly, Florence Tangle, Light Angle, is talking about, she was observing that because of the actually she is the British statistician, and she is the now considered as a mother of this nursing branch. Actually, there were no nursing, but she as a volunteer herself as a for the cure or the help of the wounded soldier in the World War I, and that's why in fact she has been at that times what she has observed that because of the ill housing conditions. People were dying, soldiers were dying of not the wound, but dying of the typhoid, cholera, and dysentery, etc. And she has advocated for improved this condition. Because of that, deaths were reduced. So these are the certain things. So based on these historical aspects, now we will be coming to the actual our topic, the definition of the epidemiology. What is the epidemiology? Epidemiology is the study of distribution and determinants of health related states and even in the population. So in our case, this population, suppose in the first example, what we talked about, people who are living in the hostels, some event that what has occurred, that event which has occurred was the diarrhea or the health related status. And distribution, we have seen that it has occurred in the 30 people. These 30 people may be living in the floor, first floor, second floor, or at all the floors, etc. And what determines that whether the food has determined contaminated food or contaminated water. So that types of the study when we are doing, and what the application after is identifying that there is no eureka moment. After that eureka, I find out the cause of the diarrhea in the hostel. No, you have to now identify the cause, not the jubilation like a eureka. In fact, you have to now have to action. So it should be your findings, observations should be followed by the application for control and the cure of that particular problem. So removing that source of infection. This is all about the epidemiology. I am skipping this because enough things we have talked about. So I will not talking about. So to summarize all how epidemiological studies, science of the epidemiology studies evolved side by side of the medical science based on three. When we are talking about the E, So there are four E. One is the E of the epidemiological studies, but besides that, there are other three E's are there. One is the empirical, another is the experience, and third is the evidences. So usually when we are starting the medical sciences world, usually we are empirically doing certain things. Okay, chalo, we'll try this thing. A, try, we'll try B, we'll try C, we'll try this, something like. So empirically, and based on empirically, people started gaining some experiences. And now we are having experience, so we are more confident. Okay, fine, this will work and this will not work. So definitely experiences over the period of time, definitely experience will be giving you good understanding or correct understanding. But not all experiences are worth, and not all people are capable to grasp the experiences and convert it into the practice. So that has to be converted into science, not an individual person, because person will die and that experience will lost. So newer people will start empirically and will be treating the patient and then gaining the experience at the time of the peak of experience. The loss will happen once he will be dying. So that should not be the method. So it has to be converted into science. For that, now it has to be whatever the experience we have gained put into the books as an evidences. And that's why our medical science from empirical to now come to the evidence-based medicine. Now what we are saying that. So evidences has come into the part, and where the for generating these evidences, epidemiological studies are there. So basically what we are saying that it identified the cause or the etiology, extent of the, determine the extent of the disease problem. So what we are, 30%, 20%, 50% cancer is happening, or the study the progression of the diseases or effectiveness of the preventive and therapeutic measures. So whatever the earlier examples we said, now you can see that these are all the examples of the knowledge you are practicing. These are the basically the aims of the, or the output of the epidemiological studies and the aims of the epidemiological study when we are doing it. So now with this, all your experiences, we have tried to link with the your theory or basics of the science. Now, and this you have understood the need of the epidemiological study. Now we'll be talking the types of the epidemiological studies. So for this, all the sciences or the facts or evidences generated, we have to use the different epidemiological studies. So different types of the epidemiological studies are there. Broadly, they are divided into descriptive epidemiological studies and another is the analytical studies. Descriptive studies just describing it. It is a typically purely observational studies, not even observational study, whatever the thing are there, we are just describing. The known is the ecological studies. There are the case reports, case series. No, it is not a report, case series, and there are the cross-sectional studies. So these are the four types of the typical common descriptive studies are there. So we are not doing any analytical brain, much more of a brain work we'll be saying. Just whatever we are seeing, we are just writing it down. We are describing it. Suppose one child is seeing that this, I have seen this animal. So he's describing the animal. So similarly, we are seeing something that we are describing. It is very primitive, but it is also very important at the same time. So it is the precursor of the advanced types of the studies. So it is the descriptive studies. But once just not only seeing and describing, you have to now be more observant, and along with observant, you are now having the more analytical part also.
So
that there are the, in the analytical studies, there are two types. One is the purely observation. You are analyzing, but you are just observing the participants or the subjects who are under the study. Then there are the experimental types of studies where you are actually experimenting something. Like we have seen the two or three experiments. Washing hand was the one experiment. And then another thing is that we have seen that giving the lime juice, etc., even the vaccinating the with the cow and the pox and the smallpox serum, etc. So these are the experimenting. You are doing some intervention here in the, typically you are not doing, but you are doing whatever the information we are getting, both the things, you, that informations, facts and figures, you are now having the advanced level of the analysis that you are doing, some analysis you are carrying out, and that's why they are called as the analytical studies. In the previous one, descriptive, we were not just describing, no analysis, no brain work, largely. Here, good intellectual faculties we are putting at the work. So this is all about what I have said, that descriptive studies, typically, which is the observational, while analytical are the observational and experimental. Descriptive is largely talking about the what is happening and what is happening. Just coming to the another slide we'll be talking about. This is largely talking about the, it lays the land of this, typical surveys are what we are doing. It lays this survey of the base of the higher types of the studies, we'll be saying that. Like treatments, response following the access treatment methods of patient reported one is a presentation in novel phenomena, case reports and case series by we are identifying and just describing these cases, just describing what you are making as a presentation. I am presenting this case. So this size of the case is you are making the presentation. And this is helping into generating hypothesis. When you are doing a thing, it helps into the generating the hypothesis. It means that when you are saying that, it means that when you are observing one case or series of the cases, it gives the suspicion. Mujhe lag raha hai, it seems that this may be the cause, because this is commonly we are seeing that happening it in one case or three cases. Then we have to move forward from case reports to case series and generating hypothesis. It is linking now actually the clinical medicine from epidemiological science to the medical sciences and clinical science, and helping us to suspect, not identify, but suspect the risk factor or the cause. And that is the generating the hypothesis. So these are some of the examples that they have observed, described the case series well. The thalidomide person, some of the patients, women, they have taken the thalidomide during their pregnancy, and they see that a baby born to such women who have taken this particular drugs are having such types of the baby born. So it was by series of case series, they identified that thalidomide may be the reason, may be the suspected reason behind, cause behind, and further it was identified. Similarly, HIV, when it was for HIV AIDS, it was observed that in 1981, it was published in 82 or 81, it was observed that there are the people who are reporting with the Kaposi sarcoma, squamous cell carcinoma, which is unusual, and they are typically having the homosexual natures. So, and they are having typical types of the other symptoms. So that's why it come to know that something new disease has come. So that is the, by case series, case reports, even newer diseases identified, causes identified, diseases are identified. Then we come to the observational analytical side, which is the cross-sectional studies. It is the cross-sectional is like a snapshot. Cross-sectional, if we are taking the cross-section of the any item or some, you will be seeing that it gives us that one layer, that information of that particular time frame or that particular layer. So it is a cross-sectional, it is said. It is helpful in the prevalence, identifying the prevalence of the, but it has got denominator. That is the, well, in the case of the descriptive study, usually we are not having the denominator. Here we are, along with that, we are having denominator. It means that we are comparing, making comparison or reducing certain rates, ratios or something, information additionally, just not describing. We are identifying out of 130 people having diarrhea. It means that 30% attack rate is there. It means something is there. Where in the case series, we are not having that something like. So it was not in case series, we are not describing it, something like. So not having denominator. Another is like a longitudinal one, not only the case substance. We are having the longitudinal type of the studies. It means that longitudinal type means studies, we are not observing one point of a time. We are observing today, we are observing after 7 days or the, depending upon the protocol, over the 1 month, 2 month, 3 month, or the 6 month, a year, 5 year, 10 year, 15 years. Over the period of a time, we are seeing that, and we are seeing that people who are actually having the obesity, they are dying of early, something like. So obesity is linked with the, such types of the longitudinal studies are there. So it helps into the identifying incidence. So there are different merits and demerits about the cross-sectional studies and the and other analytical studies, etc. But we have been seeing cross-sectional studies are the quick economic allow study of several diseases exposure, useful for estimation of population burden, it helpful in the health planning and priority setting, etc. But it has no temporal ambiguity. It is not giving actually in the case series, we are saying that in the descriptive study, we are generating hypothesis. Hypothesis means that identity, suspecting the cause of some fact or some effects, maybe positive effect because of the drugs or vaccine, or maybe the some other negative effects like the disease health outcome. So it is, we are suspecting there's some exposure with the health outcome. Here, when we are saying that, so in cross-sectional also, it giving better level of this generating the hypothesis, or the we'll be saying that it is again we'll be saying this helping in the generating the more hypothesis. That is, so that was the precursor of hypothesis. In this cross-sectional study, you can have this, some hypothesis. It is the what the defined population you are gathering information about the exposure and outcome, and you are. When you are looking, so you having four types of the things with exposure and having positive exposure, positive outcome, positive exposure, negative outcome, negative exposure, positive outcome, and no exposure, no outcome, etc. And they are basically analyzed. These four groups are analyzed. One of the important element that subsequent two studies will be there, but I have tried to show on here time frame. In cross-sectional study, in fact, we are on the one plane of the time snapshot, and one point of a time we are there. While in case of the longitudinal, two longitudinal studies, one is known as the case control and the cohort. One is the forward looking, that is the from today, from exposure to the outcome, while another is the backward looking, that is from outcome to the exposure. The cohort is the exposure to outcome, that is the forward or the prospective type of the longitudinal study, while the case control is outcome to the exposure. It is a retrospective type of the studies. There are some exceptions are there. We'll not as of now discussing today, but there are the exceptions. But typically, cohort studies is forwarding from exposure to outcome, case control is from outcome to the exposure, and cross-section at particular point of a time that you have to understand about the direction of the study. Case control studies, here now we will be having the cases and we are having the controls. Just I will be giving this showing this graph, so this will be helpful. In fact, now we just we have shown the now in the series of the studies from cross-sectional study, we are coming to the case control, which is the better study. When in the field we are identifying certain actual cases, in the cross-sectional we don't have the, we have the denominator from the population, we are dividing into the four groups. Here we are what doing, we are identifying the cases. And now out of that cases, we are matching some and having the similar type of the identifying the group of comparison, that is known as the controls. So these both people are now, the histories of these both people are taken, and backward their histories from backward from today. That is the outcome is already cases already occur. From that, we are seeing, trying to see which of the group are having the more presence of suspected etiology and which are not having absence of suspected etiology in this four group. So what in the four different groups we have seen, the similarly in the group we are seeing that, but what we have seen in the case studies, similar thing we are seeing in the case control, but we are case control, we are going prospect backwardly, longitudinally. It has got advantages, it's quick and cheap, it can study the rare diseases, it can evaluate multiple exposure, etc. Now we are coming to the cohort studies. It is comparatively better cost than the case control studies. It has got no temporal ambiguity. So it means that one of the cause, it gives that time relationship with the cause and the outcome. It can give several outcomes at the same time, and it can also estimate the some incidences, etc. It can give the effect, that is the risk, also risk ratio. So it is this way we can see that here in the present, here we are, and we are now moving towards in the future. So in we are having a group of people, no cases there, no control is there. So here the group of people are there. Out of them, over the period of a time, we are seeing how many of them have developed the disease and how many of them have not developed the disease. So that will be, now we are dividing into the based on the outcome, not based on the exposure. In case control, we have divided into based on the how many out of the cases, we are divided into the cases into how many were having exposure and how many were not having exposure. In control, we are dividing into the how many were exposed, how many were not having the exposure. So there we are having the four groups, from the cases, two from the cases, two from the control. Here there is no cases, we are dividing all the people. Cohort, they are this one group of the people who are sharing the same characteristics. They are now, identification of cohort is the question here. I'm not going into as of now in detail about, just giving the understanding about it. Identifying the cohort has become very much important here. Then after this, people will be dividing into the complications or health outcome, positive health outcome or cases and no cases, etc. So it has got advantages. I talked about that temporal, that is time relationship will be giving, but along with that, it is giving the absolute risk, relative risk, risk difference and attributable risk. Presently, I'm not giving the detail about, but mainly thing, it gives the measurement of different types of the individual risk, relationship with the strength of the risk, and also risk difference between the two different group of the people and also overall in the population. So these are the different types of the measurement of the cause and its risk with the people or the group of the people can be identified through these cohort studies. Okay. So it has got disadvantages, high cost, long duration, large sample size, some ethical issues are there also, some confounding factors are there, attrition ratio is there, it is not good for rare disease, etc. Certain disadvantages are there. So that is the about the cohort study. Now the last is the experimental study design, where we are doing actually some intervention, etc. So typically, I will be coming to this. These are the trial where we are doing some intervention or experimenting and we are observing. It may be a control type, it may be not control type. In control type, it means that we are doing intervention and we are having similarly some controls for making that for the comparison, etc. But and other may be not control type. For example, when we see the experiment done by the Edward Jenner or experiment of the vaccination or experiment done of the wash hand washing by the Ignace Semsevels hand washing. So they have not any control. They have just pre and post types of the thing they have tried to observe. So it is not control type. But when we are seeing the James Lind experiment carried out the James Lind, what he has done, he is having the control. What he has done in control, he is having the one group where the lemon juice of the and fruits, citrus fruits were given, other group nothing was given, and tried to compare both the things. So that is comparison between that of were carried out through control. This control can be randomized, cannot be randomized. Further, it can be blinded, it not be blinded. So with increase ever. With every level of the this intervention steps methodology, quality of the trial, clinical trial, or the experimental studies improves. So that is the important thing. So it is the considered as a gold standard based minimum bias or no bias practically. It can control the confounders and by randomization we can have the comparable group, etc. But disadvantage is having may affect this expensive compliance problem, long term follow up. Large trial may affect statistical power, certain ethical issues are also there. So these are the things that we have to think about. Systematic review, we have experimental study. Systematic review and the meta-analysis, they are not the part of the epidemiological studies, but they are the one of the important research methodology. Many times it is being asked about the, and you have to just have the understanding about the systematic review and the meta-analysis. So conceptual understanding only, need not to go into detail about the. You have to just have the brief idea about the experimental studies, detail about the case control, cohort studies, and the cross-sectional studies. These are the three important studies you have to have in detail, some understanding about the experimental studies, and just conceptual understanding about the meta-analysis and the systematic review. So first of all, systematic review. Systematic review is there. You must have come across that different types of the, based on these research studies, publications are there. You are reading the journals or the newspaper. Someday some people will be saying that this is effective if salt is leading to the hypertension. After some other studies say salt has no effect on the hypertension. So you will be finding this different types of the studies findings which are contradictory. Now the problem is that which to believe and which not to believe. So what now you will be doing? So by single study, what we have understood there, why epidemiology, by observing single individual, we cannot have the converted as a part, converted into the science. Before converting that observation in single person, we have to methodological study to convert into the science. But again, and that's why in fact large number of the group of the people we have to study methodologically to convert into science. But again, not a single study by findings or observation of single study cannot be converted into the science. We have to see number of the studies, and after reviewing the number of the studies, we are triangulating the informations, synthesizing the informations, and based on the synthesis, now we are saying that majority 10, 50 out of 100 studies, 50 studies, 70 studies, 80 studies are giving these types of the finding. It means that these may be the science. So converting one finding, one observation or results of one study is not the evidence. This evidence is to become the evidence. Again, it has to pass through another filter, and where the large number of the studies are being compiled, they are read, their qualities are assessed, they are evaluated, and their findings are synthesized, and then come to the one information, which is the science. Another similarly is the meta-analysis. In meta-analysis, again, we are having the finding the similar kind of the studies, but here just we are not synthesizing the results. Here we are actually one step ahead, where we are actually compiling the data of the all the informations, and this data combining the results, and then you yourself are analyzing. So it is better way of the systematic review. So studies of the studies are the systematic review and the meta-analysis, and then so studies of the studies actually give this real evidence and this science, converting to science. Systematic review, this is an example that there are maybe certain systematic reviews are also meta-analysis. Meta-analysis are also part of the systematic review, but certain are not there. This need not to know about it. But to summarize, two things in the summary I will be saying. One thing is that epidemiological studies are two types: descriptive studies, observational types, types of the studies. Descriptive studies talks about what is the health problem, when, where, and who. These are the three questions it are addressing. TPP, typically what in the our clinical thing we are saying, the vitals, three vitals are TPR. In epidemiological studies, we are having the TPP, time, place, and person, not the TPR. And it is showing the pattern when it has occurred, where it is occurring, and who are typically affected of. So what is the problem? First, we are identifying, and out there, the identifying, the describing that problem, we are trying to describe the three patterns, that is when, where, and who. That is the about descriptive studies in nutshell, usually. Then we are the observational analytical studies. It gives answer to why and how. Why some people, so why it is occurring in the rainy season, why it is occurring at the night time, why it is occurring this during weekends, etc. Why it is occurring after 2 or 3 years of growth. So why it is occurring in Himalayan belt, why it is occurring in urban area, why it is occurring in rural area, why it is occurring in the western countries, why it is not occurring in temperate zones and occurring not in occurring in tropical zones. So that types of the answer. So we are not getting through descriptive studies, we are getting through that why this group children are affected here, or why the poor socioeconomic people are affected, why obese people are affected. So these all types of the answer we are getting through analytical studies. And how? So sequences also, how they, this causes or effects can be, whatever the determinants are there can be taken care of, etc. So descriptive studies generate the hypothesis, case control and cohort studies case the hypothesis, that is the your cause and outcome relation, causal relationship, exposure and health outcome relationship. So descriptive studies, again to summarize, is helping into generating the hypothesis by answering 4 W, what, where, and where, who, while in analytical studies, case control and cause studies is talking about why and how, where they are testing the hypothesis. It means that Now, whatever the suspect, you are suspected, you are testing it, whether whatever you are suspected is right or wrong. So that types of the thing will be also why answer we are getting or test through the testing. So like we are testing that now we have to do the test whether whatever he is saying is right or wrong, something like we are doing the light detecting testing, something like not we are doing. Similarly, we are testing that whatever the suspicion we are having. So that testing is carried out. And experimental studies are actually confirming our hypothesis. So this is the whatever the causal effect relationship what we have observed, suspected from observation to suspicion, suspicion to the testing, to testing to the confirmation. And based on this etiology, experimental studies, we are confirming the cause effect or the effects. So this is about the all about the epidemiological studies. And when we are seeing the evidence pyramid, the case report, this is the at the bottom. So through case reports or the case series, we cannot deduce the sciences, convert it into the whatever the evidence or information observation we are not converting into as a science. Case control studies is the higher level, even higher cohort studies. These are the observational studies, but they are again weak at the bottom layer. Experimental studies are the actually the important at the higher level of the evidences. So better evidences, these are the circumstantial evidences. These are the direct evidences we'll be seeing that. Okay? So direct observation, if somebody has said circumstantially, we are saying that he may be the criminal, he has done the murder. Circumstances are saying nobody has directly observed it. Yeah, eyewitnesses, we can say eyewitnesses, directly somebody has observed it. So it is something like, so this is experimental studies, but again, that is not sufficient enough. So these are the studies of the studies where the systematic review and meta-analysis is the highest level of the evidence of the pyramid. When the, whatever the cause or effect or any information, piece of information, new information has come in the medical science has to pass through these all types of this series of the method studies, and when once it passed through all this, it becomes the part of this medical science or your textbook, and then as a part of your become the practices. And that's why modern science is having the respect, because it is not just out of some any empirical whims or empirical being practiced empirically. It is not just practicing based on this experiences only. It is practices with hardcore evidences which has passed through series of the test. And that's why importance of the epidemiological studies is become very, very important. And the medical doctors should know about the epidemiological studies through which what information sciences come into the emerge into the medical science we are practicing. So this is all about the need and different types of the epidemiological studies and their different levels of the evidence generating and certain understanding about the epidemiological studies from our side. So thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. We have a few questions from the students. I will take it. All the delegates, if you have any questions, please place it in the chat box. I will ask sir. And if anybody in the Zoom have any doubts, they can ask by unmuting themselves. Sir, one more request. As our JP publishers, as our educational partners, we will play their PPT during Q&A session. So can I play it? We will take questions from the background. Yes, sir, we have a question.
Pardon, I have to share the PPT, na?
No, sir, I have the PPT, sir. I will share it. Sir, we have the first question. Sir, why is cross-sectional study included in both HATS, a descriptive and analytical study?
Yeah, very rightly you have mentioned. In fact, that is the dilemma. So what actually you are doing in cross-sectional studies, many times you are gathering the information. And when you are gathering the information, that is the cross-sectional is just particular point of a time you are gathering information. Then after whatever the observations you have made, what that you are doing with that information makes it either the descriptive studies or either the analytical studies. So coming to the, is that if you are restricting yourself to describing in time, place and person only and not going further detail, then it will be restricted to the cross-sectional study, is a descriptive studies only. You are describing five people where this has happened. This is five people were affected. 10 people were children. 10 people were aged group. This aged group where these are the living in the urban area. These were living in the rural area. So you are just describing things. But now you are, if going for the further analysis and trying to have some deducing like rates. What is the prevalence rate? How many of them are affected? How many are not affected, etc. So certain rates, ratios, etc. If you are deducing out of that in facts and figures, then it could be converted into the analytical type of the studies. So every cross-sectional studies may not have that types of the quality where the facts, these rates and ratio can be converted into. But there are the typical type of the case study, cross-sectional studies where not methodology is not sample proper. Sampling techniques and sample size are not followed in that types of the cross-sectional types of the survey. It is largely, we cannot have the analysis and largely it is restricted to the as a descriptive studies. But when we are methodologically for applying the ensuring two things, adequacy and the representativeness, that is by sample size and the sampling technique. When we are adding these two parameters in the cross-sectional studies, and then whatever the information we are getting, we are converting into the rates and ratios. That is the one step level advances, not just compiling of the information, then it becomes the analytical studies. So it is some changes in methodology and way of processes what we are doing with the information gained through the studies.
Okay, sir. Sir, one more question is, need an institutional ethical permission. Like in recent scenario, I have been seeing many surveys. I mean, e-surveys which we are receiving in many WhatsApp group. Do cross-sectional studies or survey studies which collect data through online need institutional ethical permission? And what are the where are the conditions where we can where we can waive the institutional ethical approval?
Can you just repeat? Just in between, I think their voice was, cracking. Voice was cracking, so I could not understand. Can you repeat it a bit loudly?
Yes, sir. Like few students are asking that recently in COVID-19 scenario, there are many online e-survey studies which are conducting. Like, do the type of studies require IEC, and what type of studies need IEC, and in which scenario we can acquire of ethical approval?
Good. I think there are different types. Ideally, every study should have the institutional ethical permission. Ideally. Reason being that you may be thinking that these studies may not be having any ethical problem, but it may be from your perspective. It might have happened that I am asking online about the sexual histories and the person is not having the one-to-one, but there may be some ethical issues because whatever the way you are getting the information, whether privacy is there or not there, whether it will be it will be affecting in the long run to that particular person who has participated through online or something there. So that way you don't know many times what ethically you have breached the cross the border of the ethics. So many times, that's why in fact every study should have the ethical permission. But certain public health types of the studies, many times we don't require the ethical permissions in that case. But and that you can carry out. But again, that judgment whether it does not require the ethical or it does not require ethical permission or require the ethical permission, that judgment and wisdom should be left with the ethical committee. Once you will be submitting it, there are different types of the ethical approval are there. One is that exempted from the ethical. It means that based on that, they will be saying that this study does not require the ethical permission. It can be exempted. Certain things they are in the ethical permission are called as the expedite ethicals, where you are not finding much more ethical issues. So two or three small group of the people can go through it and they are finding that that is not a major ethical issue, and they are expedite types of the review they are carried out. And one full-fledged review by the ethical committee where all the representatives from the different branches of the science to the social sciences to the activists and neutral people, other neutral law, legal people, etc. All are there. They are going through the studies, methodology, and they are now seeing that, okay, that's not, no, there is no ethical issue and you can go for the study. Or these are the ethical issues should be guarded about. So ideally, every issue should be, before, nowadays, it is a practice that it we have to ethical, it has to be submitted to the ethical committee, and ethical committee has to decide whether it is to be done permission or required or not required.
Okay, sir. Like, sir, recently many organizations are conducting some webinars or some workshops, and they want, and they have pre-event forms and post-event forms, and they can assess the impact of workshop or the impact of the webinar. If they want to publish the impact of workshop or impact of the webinar as a, not an original research article, as in a letter or a commentary article or perspective article, like, what are the role of institutional ethical approval in it? Because it is from an organization where multiple students from multiple institutions will there. So, like, what are your suggestions for those types?
These are typically falling in academical type of the research. Academical research is there, and where there is no interventions, as such intervention is there. So many times academically interventions are put into the exemption of the, again, not all academical interventions are exempted, but academical, typically academical studies are put into the exemption category. So many times what happens now as a good journals, when you are publishing, they always insisting on of having the academic ethical permission. But certain journals, when they are seeing that, when they are publishing it and there is ethical certificate is not there, and if you are going for the publication, they will see, and they will say, okay, as such, this is the because of their judgment, because we are in the transition phase. So we are from no ethical approval to the ethical approval. So presently in the transition phase, it has not become mandatory, and not all journals are following that every study for publication submitted should have the ethical clearance. So in that case, they are using their judgment and they are publishing. Otherwise, even though this is the academical study, if you are as a part of your report, you are including it into this, your training report, if you are including, it's well and fine. But when it has to be submitted and be published in the peer-reviewed journal, ideally it should have the certificate from the Institutional Ethical Committee, ideally.
Yes. Sir, one more question we have is, sir, we have one question. The question is, sir, what is the role of the collaborative research in medical students? Because, like, we received the question, because many students have not getting that much support, the expert from the institution, because of this lockdown, some various reasons. So, like, if they have one friend from another institution or another state where they can get an IEC from their college, but in that scenario, how should they collaborate for the research, and what are the points that should be kept in mind during that case?
There is as such a rule, when whatever the study you have to carry out, usually a jurisdiction of 30 kilometers from the Institutional Ethical Committee is there. So if the Institutional Ethical Committee is there, then the jurisdiction, because now every academical institute should have their Institutional Ethical Committee. And now it is even hospitals are also, now they are creating their own ethical Institutional Ethical Committee, if they are the large institute, etc. are there. So they are having the Institutional Ethical Committee. The jurisdiction typically is falling around 30 kilometers. Ideally, but again, this jurisdiction is not so strict, because nowadays we don't have the 31 kilometer or 35 kilometer. We are having another institutional ethical committee. So largely institutional based studies, wherever you are carrying out, that institutional should have the ethical committee and you should have the ethical approval from the same institute where you are carrying out the studies. When it comes to the population type of the studies, wherever the usually the investigators are there, largely principal investigator is there.
Yes, sir. Where,
from that institute, permissions we should take permission largely. When it is multi-centric type of the study, so ideally every center should take their own independent ethical approval, no? And approval from Delhi. If somebody is going from Delhi or Chennai, and if I am doing at Ahmedabad or Mumbai, they are carrying out the study. That ethical approval usually is not applicable if it is multi-centric type of the study. Where the again, so I have to take approval, ethical approval from my institute. The only advantage is that what is written is that once if it is approved by some other institutional ethical committee, largely you can see and some positive side I always see, consider if we have received approval from another institutional ethical committee. But it is not guaranteeing that, because it might happen that they may have overlooked certain ethical issues and another ethical committee may come to the know about it. So it is not mandatory, but largely it is helpful in having the expedite types of the review or the approval of, from the institutional ethical committee. Typically now the situation is that now we are having online type of studies where we are giving the SMSing or sending the Google form through WhatsApp, etc. And students or any participant is sitting somewhere in America, somewhere in the Kerala, somewhere in the Kashmir, then Kanyakumari are there, something like is there. So in that case, again, these are the things where the no boundaries are there. In just types of the studies, typically investigator, wherever the investigator is from, whichever the institute investigator from, there the ethical permissions should be taken.
Thank you, sir. And the last question of our event, sir, like as our organization is focused on based both medical education and research, like what are your advices for medical students towards research?
Research is the considered the highest level of the professionalism. Typically, what we are many times in typically in the medical science, what we are seeing, largely we are restricting ourselves to the practice. So what happens based on the three E's I have described, empirical to experience to the evidence. Now I will be, first E is not there. Empirical has changed to the education. Education, then we are practicing and gaining the experience, and experience to the evidence is largely what happened, that after education we are restricting ourselves to the education experience level only. But what I have said, that whatever the experience you have gained with you, when you will be leaving, you will be losing the this, that will be the knowledge lost to the entire world. So now as a part of your it is your moral responsibility. One thing is that, and even that whatever the experience you have gained, you should use that experiences and try to convert into the science. So that would be the greatest contribution to your profession from which you have gained the your bread and butter, your fame, your name, your fame, etc. So I think we should always convert ourselves, graduate from consultant to the researcher, which is the highest level of the professional experiences. So even though if somebody saying that I'm professor, it develop the proficiency professor, it doesn't mean the developing professor. It means that you should have the good research understanding and research contributions, etc. So highest, if you have to gain the highest level of the of your status in your profession, you should develop the understanding and skills for the research, and you should contribute in the field of the medical science through good quality research studies.
Yes. Thank you so much, sir. With this, I will proceed for the vote of thanks. So we are very grateful to have you here, sir, because we read your book and we learn the things, and listening the same thing from the authors will give us an immense pleasure and the experience. So we are very grateful to have you here, and our sincere thanks to JP Medical Publishers and Dr. A.M. Kadri, sir, for being a part of our conference. So thank you so much, sir. Delegates, have a nice
day. Thank you very much for the opportunity. Thank you. Pleasure. It was all.